Welcome everybody to this distinguished lecture here at the University of Southampton. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Mark Spearing, and I have the honor of being the Vice President for Research and Enterprise here at the University. So again, welcome to this distinguished lecture. It is a real pleasure to introduce our speaker this evening, Dorothy Bishop. Dorothy is indeed extremely distinguished. She may not be unique, but she is unusual in being a fellow of the Royal Society. Well, we're all unique, right? Yeah, amongst psychologists and educationalists. But she is a fellow of the Royal Society, a fellow of the British Academy, and a fellow of the Academy of Medical Sciences. And I tell you, there are not many who can claim those are three very distinctive and distinguished honours. She is, by profession and background, a developmental neuropsychologist specializing in communication and linguistics and learning amongst particularly children with communication impairments. And she's a fellow of St. John's College, a supernumerary fellow of St. John's College, Oxford, and is a Wellcome Trust principal researcher at Oxford. And her main research interests on the causes of developmental language impairments and a particular focus on psycholinguistics, neurobiology and genetics, which is a mouthful for an engineer, which is my profession. But that is all almost irrelevant to what she's going to talk to us about today, with a nicely provocative title up above me. A lot of what she'll be talking to us today is about a wider set of interests, about open access, about reproducibility of research, and based on a very long-standing and successful blog, Bishop Blog, which features a number of issues around and about higher education and research. And so her opinions on TEF, I think, largely started and have been informed by the blog and the interactions based on the blog. So, without further ado, it is a great pleasure to introduce Dorothy Bishop to talk to us about what's wrong with our universities, and will the teaching excellence framework put it right? And with the higher education bill, it's very much in the news at the moment. So please join me in welcoming Dorothy.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and it's a real pleasure to be here. One of the things I'm going to do is to mention quite a lot of references to things that are more on the web than traditional references. So these references are all going to be found if you search on SlideShare for Dorothy Bishop or DV Bishop, my pen name, you can find them. But I'll put that up again at the end. So I'm speaking on this topic, which is very unusual for me. In fact, this is the first time I've talked on this topic, so you are getting the fruits of my initial thoughts. Usually I talk about developmental disorders in children, so what has prompted me to go in this direction? It is, as you've heard, it's largely to do with my blogging activities, where I've sort of branched out, and I started a blog really to have a safety valve to get rid of things that made me cross. And I then, through that, made contact with something known as the Council for Defence of British Universities, which is a group, a quite diverse group of people who got together a few years ago with concerns about the marketisation of higher education. And partly through them, and I became very interested in the Higher Education and Research Bill, and in particular the Teaching Excellence Framework, which is what I'll focus on tonight. But what I'll be saying is, first of all, something about the case made by the government for why we need a Teaching Excellence Framework or a TEF, the responses that were received to their consultation on this, the validity of the metrics that have been proposed to measure teaching excellence, the cost-benefit analysis of the TEF. And you might be already anticipating that much of my conclusion will be that I'm not terribly in favour of the TEF. And what I will finish with very briefly is saying something about alternative approaches that I think could restore the balance of teaching and research, which I do see as something that is much needed. But overall, I'm going to take you through really a sort of historical account of it and how we got where we are. Starting with the case that the government has made for us needing a teaching excellence framework. This was set out in a green paper in November 2015, which you can get off the web, and I didn't even understand at the start of this how green papers and white papers and things fell into place, but basically the green paper is plans laid out which will are relatively preliminary, where people are invited to consult on what's there before it gets put into a more formal form in a white paper, which then may get translated into a bill. And so in November 2015, interested parties were invited to comment, and one of the first things I did when I looked at this with my colleagues from the CDBU was to see where the information was about how we could say we didn't think we needed a TEF, because I didn't think we did. And unfortunately, there was no question about this at all. We were just told, you know, we're going to have a TEF, and this is what we're going to do. Would you like to comment on it? And the rationale, apparently, for this and the justification for thinking there was no need to discuss whether we needed it was that it had been in the Conservative manifesto. In a single sentence, you might be forgiven for missing it, but they did say, we will introduce a framework to recognise universities offering the highest teaching quality. And because of that, they felt the government, once they were in power, they should go ahead and do this, because they promised that they were going to do it, they were going to do it. And in September, Jo Johnson, the Minister for Universities and Science, started laying the ground for preparing us for what was to come and explaining why we needed it. And this is a lecture he gave in September 2015, where he said, I hear this when I talk to worried parents, such as the physics teacher whose son dropped out at the start of year two of a humanities program at a prestigious London university, having barely set eyes on his tutor. Her other son, by contrast, studying engineering at Bristol, saw the system at its best, worked off his feet, plenty of support, and mostly excellent teaching. This patchiness in the student experience within and between institutions cannot continue. There is extraordinary teaching that deserves greater recognition, and there is lamentable teaching that must be driven out of our system. It damages the reputation of UK higher education, and I am determined to address it. Right. Well, there was subsequently a select committee. These happen as well. After a green paper, you have a group of people getting round together at a table and asking experts what their views are and really quizzing them. And he was quizzed quite thoroughly and asked, where's the evidence that teaching is patchy and lamentable? And what Jo Johnson replied was this. This is all, you can read this in Hansard or wherever. In the NSS 2015 survey, two-thirds of providers are performing well below their peers on at least one aspect of the student experience, and 44% of providers are performing well below their peers on at least one aspect of the teaching, assessment, and feedback part of the student experience. I read this and I thought, I don't know how many of you have heard of Lake Wobegon and Garrison Keillor. Lake Wobegon is the place where over half the children are above average. You know, or all the children are above average, I think, in Lake Wobegon. I mean, this is a bit like that. You know, how can you have two-thirds of the children, not the children, sorry, the universities, well below average? This is a bit peculiar. So I thought I should perhaps look at the evidence. So I dug out the data on the NSS 2015. This is what it looks like. This is the overall item on at the end of the NSS, which says, overall, I am satisfied with the quality of the course. And it ranges, as you see, from strongly disagree through to strongly agree. And it's really rather remarkable. You don't really get the sense that there are two-thirds of providers performing well below their peers. Is there a glass in? Yeah, sorry, there was a glass. I think it's disappeared. yes, sorry, my voice is getting a bit croaky. It's the emotion of looking at this graph in relation to what has been said about it. Now, the thing about this graph is it's incredible because it shows a rate of satisfaction that any hotel chain would be proud of if you got this. And the percentages of who are not satisfied are down here in red and this sort of funny khaki sort of colour. So how on earth can we come to this conclusion that the teaching is patchy and lamentable, assuming that this is a reasonable measure of teaching? And I went into this in some detail because I'm sort of nerdy about statistics. And I went and did some sums on this to realise how they got this conclusion, which is true. if you define things the way they define them. The first is, if you say you're performing well below your peers, it's always the case that if you define things in terms of the average of a sample, that some people will perform above it and some will perform below it. And it is possible, even with a distribution like this, to specify an average, such as, you know, a point somewhere up here, and say, well, these may be people where, you know, maybe 82% of students are satisfied, but then you'll have some people where it's 81, 80, 78. And so you can then take a difference between the expectation and the actuality and at some point say they're well below their peers. It doesn't mean that their students are actually dissatisfied. Furthermore, if you then do that separately for each of the 22 items on the NSS, and then you say you're performing well below your peers on at least one aspect of the student experience, it's not difficult to actually get that sort of conclusion if you do the statistics in the way that they had done it. But you get the sense that somebody somewhere is trying to show that universities are rubbish at teaching on the basis of data that is not showing that. What else do they say? Well, students are dissatisfied. And they say they're concerned about value for money. A third of undergraduates paying higher fees in England believing their course represents very poor or poor value for money. Again, you can trace the source of this claim, which is the 2015 Student Academic Experience Survey published by the Higher Education Policy Institute, whose authors actually complained about the way this result had been represented by government, because they made the point very clearly in the report that this was absolutely true, that if you looked at students in England, 34% of them, the red and the blue here, thought that they had received poor value for money or very poor value for money. That was absolutely true. But they then pointed out that if you looked at Scotland, where students don't pay £9,000 a year for their fees, it was 6%. And they suggest that this diverged radically at the point at which students were asked to pay £9,000 fees. And they pointed out that there's two sides to value for money. There's value and there's money. And what students were complaining about was the fact that they were paying a lot more money for the same thing that they could see other people getting over the border, not paying £9,000 a year. If you looked again at satisfaction from these same students, it looks very like the National Student Survey, with blue is very satisfied, red is fairly satisfied. Again, sort of over 80% of students were pretty happy. So they're pretty happy with the course, they just don't like paying £9,000 a year for it. This is not to say that there's nothing in these reports that suggests that, you know, there's anything that can't be improved. Of course, there's always things that can be improved and that were commented on, and things like students were describing the information they received before starting their courses accurate, only a third of them. So they're not too happy with the information they're getting, which is another point that TEF is designed to try and address. So we're not saying nothing to worry about, but I started to get quite concerned that this didn't look so much like evidence-based policy as policy-based evidence. Twisting the evidence to tell the story that would suit them. The third claim, weak incentives on higher education providers to increase the standard of teaching. And again, this is Johnson saying, many universities see their reputation and their standing in league tables, marginal funding principally determined by scholarly output, and teaching has regrettably been allowed to become something of a poor cousin to research in parts of our system. One feels inclined to say, whose fault is that? Who introduced the ref, for God's sake? I mean, the ref indeed has had this effect. The problem is that what they then say is, well, we've got league tables for research which make people focus only on research. What's the solution? Let's have league tables in teaching, and then they'll focus on teaching and be driven in both directions. But if you go back to their original stated aim, which is to drive out poor teaching, you don't need league tables. What you need is the quality assurance agency that we've already got, that will check out institutions that are actually in trouble and where students are complaining when there's problems, which is a minority, as we've seen. But you do not need all of us to be rank ordered in terms of how wonderful our teaching is. So I have real concerns that there's another agenda here, and there is really this agenda that everything's got to be competition and a market, and that this is really what is driving this. Well, am I alone in my concerns? There were a lot of responses to the Green Paper. 618. The Department of Business, Innovation and Skills were a bit overwhelmed by this. And they said, well, it will take us a while to go through this, but we're going to look at this consultation and take seriously what people have said to us. And again, you could look at their summary of the consultation responses, which was published in May last year. I looked at it, and I looked at how people had responded specifically in this slide to questions relating to the teaching excellence framework. And I have to say, they're not looking as if the government's here not doing as well as the universities are in the National Student Survey. Because in terms of the percentages of people who agree with what is proposed, they're frequently below 50%. There's a lot of not sure, which is understandable when you look at the language used in these things, which is quite often very unclear quite what is proposed. But there are some things where you've got agreement. Should the teaching excellence framework be open to all? Why not? Yes. Should we focus on teaching quality? Okay. But once you start talking about the panels that are proposed, the timing, the need to reform the architecture of higher education, the evidence to be used in the TEF, this is where it starts to get hard to understand what they're on about. Move to differentiated TEF from year two, which is really just saying that they're going to start introducing these bronze, silver and gold awards. And then this one, which is particularly hard to understand what they're on about, they're actually talking about the link between fees and the TEF results. This is not popular, if you look here. Only a small percentage of people responding agreed with that. And the actual assessment process, disagreement. So there was a lot of unhappiness coming from various quarters. But I thought it would be quite interesting to know who was unhappy, given that we had a very diverse set of respondents. And it would be quite nice to break this down. Were the Russell Group happy and other people unhappy, or vice versa? What about the student respondents? So I requested the raw data from BIS and said, you know, your nice sort of percentages that you've put in your report, but could we see the data based on it? And I was told, this week I got this. Thank you for your email of 7th of January regarding the results of this consultation exercise. On this occasion, I have been asked to reply. I don't know what other occasions they're thinking of. And I would like to apologise for the delay in doing so. Unfortunately, we do not hold the data in the requested format. I'm sorry we're unable to help you with the request. And this, to my mind, was wonderful because it conjured up this image of why they'd taken so many months to produce this report, which was that they were working not with a computer but with an abacus. Anyway, fortunately, some places did put their responses online. And the University of Cambridge, who are, one would not think of as a sort of bastion of radicalism, they were pretty critical. Any model of a teaching excellence framework must provide a true measure of teaching excellence. A system that relies on crude or reductive metrics would be misleading to students and could create adverse incentives for institutions. The TEF must be focused on teaching excellence alone. It must not be conflated with wider policy issues, such as widening participation. This was a real issue that they kept trying to throw in all these other things that were going to give you high TEF marks. And if a TEF is associated with an ability to increase tuition fees beyond inflation, students would be forced to choose between quality, as measured by a TEF, and affordability. And this was seemed to be directly in contrast to the government's stated aim of improving access. It seemed like they were going to create, you know, the gold class universities that people could go to at vast expense, and then the cheap bargain basement universities that you could go to if you didn't have so much money but didn't mind being less well educated. I mean, it did seem very strange. So, a lot of criticism of what had been proposed. Did anybody listen? Well, the main change between the Green Paper and the following White Paper was that the TEF disappeared from the Higher Education Bill. But it didn't go away. It went ahead without government approval because they realised they don't need legislation for it. So having been told this is not a popular move, the government has moved ahead with it and let it go ahead without it requiring to go through Parliament, which the rest of the Higher Education and Research Bill is currently having a rather difficult time going through the House of Lords. So what is proposed? Well, a lot of national student survey information, so three blocks of items are going to be used, measuring teaching quality and the learning environment, and then information about student dropouts, which seems a sensible thing to measure to my mind, and then what you're doing 6 months after graduation. Fortunately, this doesn't include how much you're earning, which at one point it seemed as if it might, but it is what you're doing and whether you're doing the sort of job that they think you should be doing after you've got a university degree. And it's also noted in this document, which is what the official document about how to do it, that they are going to interpret all this information in the light of qualitative information about context. So you can write a blurb about how your university is going on with various teaching activities. So that's what's planned, and it's going ahead right now as we speak in the first year of it. And in the first year, they're just going to do it and see how it goes. But in year two, you will get awarded a bronze, gold, or silver medal. In fact, I think you might get it in year one, but it doesn't make any difference. And in year two, it won't affect your fee raising, what they call differential fee uplifts. But if you've got silver and gold, you will get the full inflationary uplift from year three. I think it sounds like some sort of bra. Anyway, there we go. So, is this a good idea? Well, I think it's going to hinge crucially on the validity of the proposed TEF metrics. So I'll just briefly, I mean, most of you will have seen these items, I'm sure, and I won't labour them at all. Just to give you an idea, these are the sort of questions that people are being asked about. The different NSS scales, teaching on my course, staff are good at explaining things. Feedback on my work has been prompt. That's one that gets rather low ratings in a lot of institutions, and I think it's because if you really educate a student, they understand that prompt means right away, which is not easy to achieve. So here are the scales that they use. What's the problem with this as a metric? Well, I'm going to go through a number of problems, and the first one is that this doesn't measure teaching quality. The Royal Statistical Society, no less, had a wonderful response to what was, it wasn't the Green Paper, but it was a technical consultation on the measures they plan to use. And they said, when asked, do you agree with the criteria proposed in Figure 4? No. Please outline your reasons and suggest alternatives and additions. It's concerning that Figure 4 equates student satisfaction, as measured by the National Student Survey, with teaching quality. We are not aware that there is any evidence of a statistical association between the two concepts. Oh, it's lovely stuff. What some research does show is that there's no reliable association between the two. Anecdotally, they add, we've heard of institutions explicitly dumbing down programs so as to result in higher NSS scores. A new TEF needs to recognise this and mitigate against it. One goal of higher education is to produce highly educated people of use to the society of the future. And the NSS inadvertently encourages the opposite. So the Royal Statistical Society really were not keen. And, you know, so they are a fairly august and serious group of people. And they were really quite scathing about several aspects of what was proposed. Then, this week, I mean, preparing this talk has been a nightmare because things keep happening. January the 25th, sorry, last week, but we had an astonishing quote from Chris Husbands, who is the chair of the TEF panel. And he was at a meeting where he was interviewed by the Times Higher Education, and he said he doesn't think student satisfaction is an accurate proxy for teaching quality. He drew attention to US studies that show that student satisfaction scores are heavily influenced by non-academic factors, including the sex or ethnicity of a lecturer. Student satisfaction seems to be driven by the physical attractiveness of academics rather than anything else, he said. So he then said, well, the TEF panel would not draw policy from a single data point and that all data are flawed in some respect, but he went on, the challenge was to recognise and understand the flaws and learn how the information could be used effectively. But this is, you know, this isn't just me. You know, there are a lot of people out there who are worried about this use of the NSS in particular. So it's problematic in terms of its validity, but it's also problematic in terms of the statistics. It doesn't discriminate between institutions, and I think this is another reason why people are beginning to realise it's a bit of a dead duck. This, again, was the Royal Statistical Society making this point, and they cite the Office for National Statistics, who also responded to the technical consultation, although in a slightly less aggressive way. This is the same data, really, that I showed you in those pretty coloured graph right early on, except that this is just lumping together anybody who was satisfied, responding four or five, and giving you the percentage of students in that category, which is, in fact, what is proposed to be used. They're losing any granularity in that scale and just making it into a binary category. But what they've added here, which is quite interesting, is these vertical lines, which are the confidence intervals around those points, which give you an indication mostly of just the size of the institution. The bottom line here is that if you are an institution with 3,000 students who you're basing your NSS on, you can be fairly confident that that's a fairly precise estimate that has some reality. But if you've got, say, only 50 students that you're basing your ratings on, then you could anticipate that if you had had just a different 50 students, it might have looked very different, and this is what these lines are really indicating. But the point that they make here is that if you're trying to discriminate here between all these people bunched up at the top here, you just can't do it. There's no way of reliably being certain that somebody who's here is actually better than somebody who's here. There's a few people down the bottom, again, who one would be worried about, but they're very small in number. So it's not discriminating. And then the other thing that is a bit worrying about the way this is done is this business that success is defined relative to all providers, and in sort of psychometric terms and statistical terms, we're talking about something that's norm referenced rather than criterion referenced. So if I were to say to you that if you've got more than 15% of your students who are not satisfied, you're in trouble, that's a criterion reference thing. It's an arbitrary line in the sand, but it's basically saying this is a point that we would start to feel worried about you if you did, you know, had that rate of dissatisfaction. But if it's norm referenced, you're doing this thing that Joe Johnson did in that earlier quote, which is that you're just sort of saying you're worse than everybody else. Even it doesn't matter how good you all are, but if you're sort of somehow a little bit behind other people, you could come out as looking a lot worse. And what happens then is that this is, I've turned this on its head to look at the proportion who are either very dissatisfied or dissatisfied, because I actually think that's what they should be most focused on. But here we have a situation, these are the genuine data from last year of institutions with the percentages of students responding either very dissatisfied or dissatisfied. And what you can see is that if you put a cutoff here at around 0.13, you capture the bottom 10% as falling to the right of that line. And they are people, you might say, yes, okay, we should be worried about them. But let's suppose we then get that group of institutions and either abolish them or improve them beyond all recognition so they move over into the other areas. So we don't have anybody in that tail. Well, then the cutoff next time round will move down. So we all have to now be better. We have to get 10%. And this could keep going on infinitely until everybody was bunched right up at the end here. The cutoff is just changing according to the population that it's based on. And this really does get a bit ridiculous if you are dealing with the sorts of distributions where you have this big skew towards most people being perfectly satisfied. So on top of that, we have the interesting question that's getting ever more interesting by the day, which is what about if a substantial number of students don't fill in the student survey, which many unions are beginning to say they won't, because as far as they can see, the only consequence of them giving their university a good rating is that the fees will go up. So a lot of student unions are recommending not completing the NSS. Furthermore, there may be institutions who look at their NSS scores and decide they're not going to submit to the TEF. They'll be taken out of that distribution. So you've got the distribution on the one hand risks being non-representative because students are not completing it. And on the other hand, it risks getting shunted more and more to the extreme, as the only people that will comply with this exercise will be the people that know they'll do well out of it. There's yet more technical questions that I have gone into in huge depth, but it's too technical and detailed and dry to sort of go into detail here, but there's a whole issue of benchmarking, which is also involved. It seems like a good idea to do benchmarking, which means that you will take into consideration the student population you're dealing with. And if you've got a student population who are all coming from with, you know, 4As at A level and very good supportive family backgrounds in a nice high SES areas, you might expect a different outcome than if you're taking a lot of people who may be either mature students or maybe people who come from backgrounds which are less supportive or with less good grades when they arrive. And so the idea is that one needs to adjust for things like that. But it gets really problematic depending, it gets conceptually problematic, and it gets statistically absolutely nightmarish to do this, because the idea is you specify a benchmark, which is the sort of score that you would get for a typical institution with that composition of people. But then you have to compare what you've got with that benchmark and work out, is it actually statistically reliably above or below it? And this has taxed the brains of some very eminent and skilled statisticians how best to do it. And this, for those of you into this sort of thing, this paper by Draper and Gittos is quite old now, but they describe the methods that are being used and how they got to use them. But they also make it very clear that the precise decisions about how you decide to go about doing this can affect the results that you're going to get, and in particular can affect the percentage of people that look as if they are failing. So it's a non-trivial thing. Interestingly enough, also in benchmarking, you have to consider what's a logical benchmark. I mean, is it reasonable to say that, you know, students who come from poorer backgrounds shouldn't be as satisfied as students who come from richer backgrounds? You know, should you adjust for that if that's the trend? Or should you say, no, if you have that sort of composition of students, you should teach them in a way that makes them satisfied? There are real problems there. So I think that I hope to have convinced you that using the National Student Survey as a measure of teaching excellence is seriously flawed, and that it is flawed conceptually and it is flawed statistically. What about a cost-benefit analysis of the TEF? I called for this a long time ago because I thought, well, we've had the REF and we know that that has done some good, but it's also been at tremendous cost, and it's also created quite a lot of perverse incentives. So we really need to anticipate, you know, what are the problems that might arise with this, how much is it going to cost people, and what are going to be the impact on your jobbing academic. And I was astonished when I then saw that there had indeed been a cost-benefit analysis of the TEF done by the government. And here it is. Here's the one page of their detailed, what they call detailed impact assessment, where they show you what the teaching excellence framework will do for us. The cost is 20 million, but the benefit is over $1 billion. And I looked at this and thought, blimey. How is that possible? It's a bit like some of Joe Johnson's statistics. I was confused by this to start with, because I thought they were talking about business in the sense that I understand business. I thought they meant, you know, the world of businesses would benefit so much from our students being better. But no, what they mean is they're universities. Mm-hmm. Universities are businesses. Right. So they estimated that it would cost about 53K per institution on average to do the TEF. There may be people here that know whether that is a realistic estimate. I mean, it's about one person's salary, I guess, for a year, one administrator. Perhaps not. Perhaps they don't earn that much. But what are the benefits? How do we get to this over $1 billion benefit? Well, this is wonderful. So what they're saying is student numbers are going to go up. This is this column. This is a reasonable estimate, although Brexit might have actually messed this one up. Inflation, they're just using estimates of inflation, which again, Brexit is throwing a spanner into the works for many of these things, but assuming this is, they're doing the best they can. And then they say, this is in real terms. So this is, if you don't have a TEF, everybody who's getting £9,000 a year per student at the moment will find that that is eroded by inflation. So in real terms, it will go down to just under £7,000 a year by 2025. On the other hand, if you complete the TEF and get a silver or gold, they're going to let you put your fees up so that you keep pace with inflation. If you get a bronze, you start off okay and then you slowly decline. And that's where the billion comes from. The billion is that you're going to do so much better if you take part in it because they're going to let you put your fees up. That is it. That's the benefit. So the question that occurred to me, they did anticipate in their report which was, why don't you let everybody increase their fees in line with inflation, provided they have a satisfactory QAA rating? They say, quality assurance is a good starting point. Reliance on quality assurance alone and in the longer term will not enable significant differentiation of teaching quality to help inform student decisions and encourage institutions to improve their teaching quality. So, in other words, we're going to do this because we want you to be competitive and we want league tables. And I did rather rudely say in my blog that the consequence of the TEF seemed to be facilitating the division into institutional sheep and goats and then starving the goats. Now, again, I used to think it was just me that was sort of getting cross about these things, but even this was another one from this week. The Vice Chancellor at Warwick has pointed out that the metrics are flawed. It's not renegade opinion, which I was quite pleased to hear because I feel I'm being a renegade. But the overwhelming view of those actually involved in higher education, but the government has us over a barrel. So it's linked the TEF to tuition fees and potentially our ability to recruit international students. So we're all going along with this because we've been told if we don't go along with it, we will basically be starved of resources. And this is the government's way of motivating people to go along with it because they know that if you didn't have the link with fees, people just wouldn't bother to go along with it. Now, I felt, doing a cost-benefit analysis, that there's more to costs than 53k a year spent on doing the paperwork. There's the costs on staff. We already have huge demands on staff from the REF. In order to be a successful academic, you have to bring in substantial grant income, you have to publish in so-called high-impact journals, you have to manage a research group and demonstrate impact beyond academia. And universities have been busy trying to recruit people who meet these criteria for the REF. Now, if we have the TEF, you also will have people who have to be available for students at all times, provide detailed and prompt feedback, give interesting lectures with enthusiasm, and ensure students go on to get good jobs. All very reasonable things to expect teaching staff to do. But the problem is, you know, how much of this can the average academic do all at once? Can one person do all of these things? I would submit not. I speak as somebody who does mainly research, and it keeps you pretty busy keeping at the top of research. And I do see colleagues of mine who have teaching jobs who are expected to do both these things now, and it's driving people insane. And on top of that, of course, you have to serve on committees and be a good academic citizen in various ways. So I'm just thinking, you know, somewhere something's got to give. We cannot keep pressurizing people to be brilliant at research, brilliant at teaching. We have to get more realistic. And what the government seems to not understand is that you can't push so much onto one group of people. So what are the alternative approaches that we might have? And I won't say much here, but I'd be interested in whether people have views on this. Professor Roger Brown wrote on a CDBU blog post a while ago that why don't we just stick student learning in the impact section of the REF? Why do we have to have this whole other exercise? That seemed to me a very good question. And another point, a more radical point, made by Sally Hunt, the General Secretary of the University and College Union, was that a lot of the problems that we currently have where people are dissatisfied with teaching is because teaching has been marginalised, and what's happened is that universities have taken on the research superstars in order to improve their REF rating, but that means that the teaching is then left to people who are casual people drafted in who have very uncertain futures in the institution and basically on insecure contracts, and that this is not good either for them or for the people that they're teaching. Again, I think that's actually a very valid point. We need to look at who is doing our teaching and whether they are adequately supported and have adequate security. So I think I've pretty much used up the time that's been allocated to me. I just want to finish with some quotes from the House of Lords. So the House of Lords, this month, it is all very topical, they've been debating the Higher Education and Research Bill. And I was rather surprised that they talked about the TEF because now it's out of the bill, but they are clearly there were a lot of concerns raised by it, about it. And what was interesting, there were concerns raised about the bill by some very eminent conservatives. Lord Paton was particularly attacking various aspects of the way the bill was being presented. And it was left to David Willetts to defend the TEF. And he did so in the most half-hearted fashion. These are they're not perfect measures. You know, people are at least beginning to agree that this. But he then said, we are on a journey, and I look forward to these metrics being revised and replaced by superior metrics in the future. They're not as bad as we've heard and some of the caricatures of them. And if, in my experience, we wait until we have a perfect indicator and then start using it, we'll have a very long wait. If we use the indicators that we have, however imperfect, people will then work hard to improve them. That is the spirit with which we should approach the test today. Lord Lipsey, before the noble lord sits down, will he explain what consolation he'll offer to those institutions which are put out of business at worst while we perfect the metric that's being used in this case? And then finally, wonderful Baroness Royale of Blaisdon. My lords, the noble lord, Lord Willett, said that we are embarking on a journey, which indeed we are. But I feel the car in which we will travel does not yet have all the component parts. I therefore wonder if, when we have concluded all our debates, rather than going full speed ahead into a TEF for everybody who wants to participate, we should have some pilots. In that way, the metrics could be amended quite properly before everyone else embarks on the journey with us. I think that's a very good point at which to end. And I'll put that there with the reading list up here if anybody wants to get the references. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dorothy, for a fascinating, very challenging discussion and very, very clearly put of all the criticisms and critique of the teaching excellence framework. I had a lot of discussion about it, but I haven't seen it presented so clearly. I just feel there are a lot of questions or comments. There are a couple of microphones around the room. If you could just put your hand up and I'll indicate where to go. Please say who you are. Dennis Nicol in the middle here. So, and we are recording this, so it, not so much so that you can be heard, but so that you can be recorded for posterity. And just say who you are. And
Hi, I'm Dennis Nicol. I teach electronics, and I'm also the UCU branch president here. Originally, the TEF applied very weak levers to the universities. Brexit has improved its leverage substantially by giving us a much higher forecast inflation rate.
Yes.
But the Warwick comment is the one I think that really excites university administrations in the short term. There is this not very well documented threat that poor performance in the second year of the TEF will have a dramatic impact on universities' ability to obtain Tier 4 visas.
Yes.
And for many universities, teaching international students is vastly more profitable than teaching UK students.
Yes.
And extraordinarily, those international students typically don't contribute to the NSS at all.
So we're
in a situation in which we have to keep our UK students on three-year degrees happy, or four-year degrees, in order to be allowed to recruit one-year MSc students who we only have to keep just barely happy enough not to create a Twitter storm or a Weibo storm denouncing us, because they don't contribute to the TEF, they don't turn up to open days and don't hear bad things in person. So if we keep the recruiting agents sweet and avoid too high a negative profile on Weibo, all we have to do is keep the UK students happy enough that we don't have our visas taken away, I think.
Thank you.
I wish you hadn't used we there.
I mean collectively the 200 or so higher education institutions.
Yeah, thank you. I will absorb what you have said and include it in future. It's a good point.
Yes, in the middle. Do just say who you are.
Yes, I'm Keir Thorpe, Faculty Education Coordinator for the Faculty for Blah, which is a proper faculty. One of the interesting things that struck me about the Green Paper was what it didn't say about TEF. About two-thirds of it is about something else, which is new entrants into the marketplace. And to some degree, I felt at the time, and I don't know whether my view has been challenged, that in fact this was all a smokescreen.
Yes.
That TEF really had nothing to do with it. Education, it was more about opening up the sector to new for-profit, as in the USA. And one of the things that's quite chilling in that Green Paper is when it says, and some existing providers will be exiting the marketplace.
Yes.
And we've just heard that, you know, this may be done effectively by starving them. But I just wondered if you had the sense that it may actually extend to killing them.
Oh, yes.
And that actually people, you know, London Met, for example, has been hammered really hard down the years. I know it had struggles, but even so, to have its visas rights stripped in the middle of the year and things like that. I wondered if you felt that there's actually a second element to this, which isn't really coming into the debate at the moment, which is actually, it's about commercialisation.
Yes, and I think that's absolutely right. I mean, in the Green Paper, there is this, a lot of it is focused on the fact that we do not have this terribly trite phrase they keep putting out, a level playing field, in the sense that it's thought that we're being very unfair to other people that want to enter the market because they're required to have accreditation from an existing university before they can have university title, and how dreadful this is and how we've got to have a more sort of marketized system. That's one thing. There's also a lot about actually the governance of universities and the governance of research councils, which the Lords have been very hot on picking up, that actually by stealth it looks as if there'll be much more government control of universities. So there are a number of things going on that are worrying. I try very hard not to be paranoid and to think, you know, that you sit there thinking, how far is this intentional? How far is the stated agenda one that is the genuine agenda? I think there is a motivation. I think this quote from Jo Johnson at the beginning about this parent that said, well, her son was having a terrible time. There are people who claim that if you know, canvassing on the doorsteps, there have been people who think that they're paying all this money, that students are not getting the right thing, and that this is a measure to achieve that. But I think that what they clearly are trying to do is to kill many birds with one stone, and to, at the same time as they hope, and I think they're completely wrrong-headed, but they hope that these will improve the teaching quality that people get. I think exactly that this is why it's all about league tables. It's about league tables because people who are right at the bottom can then indeed get exiting the market, because that's a they believe in marketization, and the sign of a successful market is that people enter and exit it. Otherwise, it's not a functioning market. So I think there is definitely an ideological thing here going on. The crazy thing is that they go on and on about these alternative providers coming in, and yet when you look at them, they're a bit of a rabble mostly. I mean, it's not as if there's very competent groups of people trying to set up universities who are being elbowed out. And there is a very worrying history of dodgy institutions that want to get university title so that they can get their hands on student fees, and then they don't actually teach people properly. So there's a very big concerns about this market in alternative providers. And most of us, I think, believe it should be very firmly regulated. Yes, we need a diverse set of different sorts of institutions providing higher education, and I would be the first to agree with that. But what they're trying to bring in is just the notion that if there's competition, and indeed, Jo Johnson has likened it to McDonald's. You know, there's McDonald's, and then there's something else, burgers. And, you know, may the best burger win in terms of what people want. This is not how universities operate, but this does seem to be how the government sees the university sector. Sorry, I went on rather long there, but get impassioned about it.
I have a question, which is perhaps more of a philosophical one. Clearly, you know, with Brexit and Trump, we're in a position where there's a strong feeling that expert opinions, data-informed decision-making is devalued, and we can have alternative truths and facts.
Yes.
What is the response that we might take to that, particularly around TEF, where you've made quite clear that the decision-making, or you put it quite nicely, I think, of policy-informed evidence-taking, or something like that. How should we respond?
I felt all along when I was involved in this was that the way to respond would be as an academic to document what is wrong with this, not just to sit there saying, you know, it would be easy to sort of just say, oh, this is all terrible. But I think if you can, you know, apply a scholarly analysis to what's going on and present it to the public, which you have to do, of course, via, you know, things like blogs and so on, and it's not difficult, it's not easy to get the government to listen. The really worrying thing is the extent to which, though, I started to think that last week we had the Council for Defence of British Universities annual lecture, which was excellent. It was by Martin Wolf on economics and the wrong-headed economics that was being applied to the sector. And we were very pleased that we had some very eminent members of the House of Lords turn up who were very concerned about these issues. And Melvin Bragg was one of them, and he stood up at the end and gave the most impassioned speech about how he'd been in the House of Lords all this time, and in all his years there, he had never come across anything where there was just so little willingness to shift at all on the basis of, you know, the Lords were giving it of their best. They'd suggested loads of amendments to try and improve things, and they were not budging an inch. And it's just like with this consultation, one felt that the consultation had said, don't link this with fees. It's a really bad idea for, and people were giving cogent reasons, totally ignored. So I think there, I think it is this same attitude that we know best. The experts, well, they're all feathering their own nests. You know, they're only interested. Of course, they would say that, wouldn't they? There's no sense of right and wrong. And I think best thing we can do is to just keep really putting it out there. The tragedy is that most academics have no idea of what's going on. Many of my colleagues, when I say I'm going to go and give a talk about the TEF, they say, what's that? Still haven't, I mean, Oxford may be a bit behind the times, and I still haven't heard of it, but you know, it's taken a very long time for there to be any awareness that there's a bill going through Parliament that is going to radically change how our universities operate. So I think we do have to just try very hard to get the word out there and get people more willing to challenge bad evidence when it's being used.
Just one comeback from me, contradict my learned colleague, Dr. Nichols, there. Actually, of course, we are and have been in a market for a number of years.
Yes.
And we compete internationally yes. for students. And I take a less cynical view. I think students come to the UK versus going to other parts of the world because we actually have a pretty good education system.
But Martin Wolf would say, yes, of course, it would be crazy to say that isn't the case, but it's not the sole purpose of education.
No, absolutely not.
But the problem is that the way that some of these reforms are being presented is that we are just businesses and all that matters is the bottom line.
I really do worry about it. Yes, please. Sorry, just wait for the mic so you can...
My name, Vincent O'Connor from Biological Sciences. I understood... as a preamble to this, I think it was our COO, suggested that the Russell Group universities, top 35 universities, would all fall at the wrong end of the TEF score to be able to claim the extra fees. So if it plays out with that sort of gradation, it will give a rather perverse reflection of British universities.
It's
in
not
which
in
the so-called... Yeah. Well, I don't know if they've modelled it so far.
I've modelled it.
Okay, so you
and there are some, you're quite right, there's some high, very eminent Russell Group universities that do not look good on the modelling. But there's not many of them. And there are also some new universities that look
fantastic
yeah, on this TEF modelling. But one of the problems is that it's very bad, if you use the modelling that they use, to be a big institution. And that's all to do with these standard errors. I mean, I don't know if you're into statistics.
No, it's perverse.
You get a very small standard error, so it's actually much easier to look as if you're falling well below your benchmark if you're a very large institution.
So we have to hope that Joe Johnson's in Waitrose with a senior academic who will... I mean, to drive the policy through anecdote is not very healthy.
No.
And will leave us vulnerable because we need to be elite. Yeah. We need to be the best to drive the...
I mean, I think...
And the other thing is, one last comment and a suggestion. Apparently, it's not legislated.
No.
So we don't have to do it.
No. Right. But if you don't do it, then there is the threat that you will not be able to put your fees up, and that so you won't be authorised to do that, and as was pointed out, you also may have problems getting visas, Tier 4 visas for your students.
When I say we, I also mean, like, Dennis, the 210 higher education.
Yeah.
I was teasing Dennis, who I know well, so it wasn't...
I mean, if everybody said that they weren't going to do it, it would be quite interesting, but that's not going to happen.
A very powerful case for us not to. Good. Of the well-being of our education system.
Mm. Yes, over here on my right. Your right.
Jane Warren, School of Education. This is actually a sort of a personal point for you. Is it going to be... like University Challenge, in the sense that are the Oxford and Cambridge colleges going to be submitting individually or as the wider institution?
I don't think there's any chance of them of the Oxford and Cambridge colleges submitting individually. I don't think they count as a higher education sort of institution in all the figures that are used by the various bodies that deal with them. The university is the university. Yes.
So. It was an interesting point in the light of what you said about size being such an interesting driver of whether you had a small or a large confidence.
Yes. And I think it would probably kill the Oxford and Cambridge colleges if they had to start doing this sort of exercise as well.
Yes, here at the front.
And there's a mic just coming.
I agree with everything you have said.
And who are you, sir? And behind the microphone is...
I'm a pure mathematician, so I agree with everything what you have said, but and I also don't like, as academic, the idea of using employment data. But as a citizen, I might find some appeal in that.
Yeah.
So do you have anything to say about employment data using employment?
I feel much less... I haven't really looked at how they're going to use it, and I feel much less concerned about that because I think that is at least hard data. The main criticism that has been put forward about the way it's implemented in the TEF is that it is only 6 months after you have graduated that they're taking those numbers from, and that's thought to be rather early in terms of measuring it. But I think it's reasonable. Initially, they did say that there was a belief that they were just going to look at how much money you earned, and I would be dead against that. Because I think that, obviously, if you've got somebody who wants to be a nurse, they're not going to earn as much as somebody who wants to be a banker, but to my mind, they might be more valuable. So I think, if you can't get a job after you've taken a degree, then I think that is an issue. I think the thing that I'm most happy with is the dropout rate. I think if people are dropping out of courses, that does suggest something's very, very wrong. So I think that would be a reasonable statistic to use. But obviously, in most institutions, that's not a terribly high percentage again. But the employment data, I haven't thought about it terribly hard, and I don't feel quite so anti it as a measure. But I think we would need to look at it over the longer term to see whether really 6 months is an adequate interval to take.
Yes, perhaps one last question up there.
Hello, Anya Tim, Faculty of Medicine. I was wondering, if we can't fight the TEF, should we be fighting the NSS?
Well, I might make myself very unpopular if I start to say yes, but I think the people who are fighting it are the National Union of Students, who are increasingly advising their members not to take part, and in many places are getting agreement from the students. And this is going to be difficult because the universities are going to want the students to fill it in. I think what the students might do if they are sensible, if they're forced to fill it in some way, would be just to give everything a one. That would be interesting. But,
Would you give that advice at your home institution?
It would be interesting, wouldn't it? I think if we got results that looked dramatically different from any previous year, it would be clear that we couldn't use it. So, in a sense, it's like a spoiled ballot. The problem is that they have us over a barrel. I would hope that... maybe we're going to have a rocky couple of years and then it will settle down, which is more or less what Willetts is saying. He's sort of saying, well, it's going to be, we know it's not right, I mean, it's not perfect, but maybe we'll find something more sensible. And it may be that, as with the REF, they will move more to something that isn't based on some crazy metric, but is perhaps more realistically looking at teaching excellence. But I think my bottom line problem is that I really don't see the need for this whole exercise, because I think it's all about more league tables. And I would say that what you need is to make sure students get adequate information, and that's already on the cards, that you have to have these on your website. You have to have the kind of information that they said students are lacking. We need to provide them with information. We need to make sure that if there is problematic universities, that the Quality Assurance Agency can deal with those. But in general, I think we should just leave people alone to get on with it and have some trust. I mean, that's what's gone out the window. The notion that we can be trusted to do anything sensible, despite the fact that our students do, on the whole, seem pretty satisfied.
Dorothy, thank you so much for so, just wait a second, please, for so clearly articulating, I think, what many of us in the room feel quite acutely at the moment, mm-hmm. and actually providing some data and rationale mm-hmm. for the arguments that we might need to make and to understand. It has been a wonderful and very distinguished lecture. We have a very small token to thank you and honour you for being with us.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us this evening, and thank you to Michelle and the team for organising it. Thank you.